Hi everyone, I'm Mike Bird, and check out my interview with legal professor John Anadzu about his book Learning to Disagree. I cannot think of a more timely book for a divided age. Later today, my wife and I are going to go see the movie called Civil War, which is about a civil war breaking out in America. In this day and age where America, Europe, Australia, Britain, we're all so divided over cultural things, we're all divided over political things, and we don't have the ability to disagree graciously. We just want to destroy our political opponents. The idea that we can have a civil discourse, a civil disagreement, seems to be near impossible. But this is a great book because it's not just a call to, civil disagreement. It gives us stories from John's own life. It gives a mixture of political commentary and his own, life story to show, you can live with differences. You can engage in the real work of persuasion rather than trying to own or destroy your enemies. And seriously, in a divided age, when we're really at each other's throats, where everyone's baiting for the blood of the left and the right, this is a book that I think is needed, and I learned a lot from it, and I know you definitely will too. So sit back and enjoy the discussion I have with John Anadzu about learning to disagree.
Will no one rid me of this meddlesome priest?
Well, hello everyone. I'm Mike Bird, and I'm with Professor John Anadzu from a you're from a law school in St. Louis. I can't remember the name of the school, John.
Washington University in St.
Washington
Louis.
University, but in St. Louis, Missouri.
Correct.
Okay. Well, I know Washington, D.C. and the state of Washington. Did not know about that Washington, but that's
It
good.
doesn't confuse anyone. No, just
Yeah, I mean, yeah, there's a few things like the words Western Seminary describes places in Michigan and in Portland, which I find a little bit baffling. But this is the same country that calls entree the main course. So
Fair point, fair point.
yeah, I think naming things has never been the strong point. But John, I've been a big fan of yours for years. I got involved in a something of an intramural debate with the Society of Biblical Literature. There were some things going on about which publishers they wanted to kick out of our annual meeting, and I had a bit of a smackdown with the CEO, and he said, "Look, when it comes to dealing with differences in a reasonable way, you've got to read John Anadzu's book, Confident Pluralism." And I thought, I don't know, finding a way to live together with a book written by a lawyer, I don't know if that's going to work. But I read the book and I loved it. It was great. And I thought it was a great antidote to a fractious and fratricidal world where people are trying to own the libs or to, stamp out white rural rage, which is, apparently the latest thing we're all against. I found it a great book about how we can live together with differences, and how we can create a politically pluralistic, multicultural democracy where we're trying to seek the best of society and not running around just trying to cut everyone's heads off because they're slightly to the left or slightly to the right of me. So that's where I've come across your work, and that's influenced my own political thought on things like the nature of secularism, religious freedom, and the Christian case for a kind of civil society. So I've been a big fan of John's work, and that book's now in a second edition, I believe, Confident Pluralism.
That's
And
right.
in addition, you also co-wrote a book with the late Tim Keller.
Yeah, that was called Uncommon Ground, Living Faithfully in a World of Difference. And think of that as sort of applying confident pluralism to a specifically Christian audience.
Yeah, which is a great thing as well. But now we've got your latest book, Learning to Disagree, and this is good. I was, to be honest, I was expecting a kind of, I don't want to be cynical, a kind of HR guide to conflict resolution, which would be basically something that you would read while the PowerPoints are on the screen. When Jill has said something that offends Bob, I was expecting a kind of like HR manual on how to live with difference. It was nothing like that. So I went in with low expectations.
Oh, that's pretty low. Those HR trainings are their own form of purgatory. So
yeah, those HR discussions. I didn't go in with low expectations, but it was not the genre I was expecting. And what we have here is really a very deeply autobiographical work, with a little bit of vulnerability on your part. You've discussed some things that have happened to you, things ranging from how you got out of traffic tickets, all the way through to dealing with students who are trying to pillory a Stanford professor, dealing with friends in hard times, suicide of students, and living with that, and faith. But I've got to say, there are two lines from the book that are my favorite. Okay, one's kind of comical, and one I think is very serious. The comical one, what I thought was funny, was on page 15. This is where you say, "Law professors are generally high on ego and low on social skills." But I can say, after dealing with you, John, I think you are definitely the exception to that rule.
In which direction?
I think you're high on social skills. So I thought that was fine. I've met one or two law professors, and emotional intelligence, I would not say was their strong point. Brilliant knowledge of case law and constitutional studies, but not those things. But that, more seriously, there was another thing where you talked about faith in a world where we disagree with people. And this is the on page 96 of the book, you say, "We do not prove our beliefs like mathematical equations or lab experiments, but we affirm our commitments to them in the way we live our lives. When we recognize that everyone places their trust in some kind of faith, we can more easily relate to those around us. Even though our actual beliefs and commitments may differ, the uncertainty and vulnerability that comes from acting in faith can remind all of us of our shared human condition." That was my other favorite line from the book, which I think shows that we've all got a belief in something, and our faith has to be lived out and applied, which reminded me of something that Soren Kierkegaard said, as you have lived, so you have believed. It's our way of life that really believes. So yeah, I thought that this book was an interesting mix of autobiography, case law, and various anecdotes. But I've got to ask, John, I mean, what led you to write the book in the first place?
Yeah, thanks, Mike, and thanks for having me here. You mentioned the earlier book, Confident Pluralism, and in many ways, I've been thinking about those ideas for a long time. And at the height of the pandemic, as I was experiencing this loneliness and isolation from everyone, and I was witnessing everybody just shouting across the ether their outrage and their disagreements over COVID policies and responses. And I just thought, well, we're not trending in the right direction here. We've got to break the fever and come out of this somehow. And how might we work on this in a more, I would say, a more applied or lived sense than a lot of the academic and theoretical work that I typically do. And it occurred to me that really blending the academic writing with the classroom, even though for many years I've taught and written about very similar issues, but the experience of teaching and the experience of writing, if I could somehow narrate that a little differently to a broader audience, that there's something about law, the learning of the law, the learning together of these kinds of challenges in the law, that is applicable to not just lawyers in training, but also people trying to figure out how to engage at the neighborhood picnic, or, well, I would usually say the Thanksgiving dinner table, but I don't think you have that in Australia. So whatever the analog would be, but the holiday that brings family together and sets people up for hard conversations with others they don't know as well as they used to, whatever that is, then I'm hoping these kinds of lessons and insights might be helpful in those situations.
Yeah, well, I think the book definitely helps in that. And it's not an academic book. It's about an academic, your own life, but it's very readable. It's very, very relatable as well, because you're talking about conversations with students, conversations with friends, conversations with people who are holding strong views and are very agitated. You know, my concern is that this is a good book, but the people who will take the most from it are probably the people who need it the least, and the people who need it the most won't read it. I mean, but let's say I do have a uncle who, in the languages, shall we call it a bit Fox Newsy, or I've got a teenage daughter who is a little bit too far into MSNBC or into kind of progressive outrage merchants on TikTok. What would be the benefit of recommending a book like these to them?
I think I think you're right that this sort of naturally appeals to a certain temperament anyway. But I would say that even to the left and right of whoever we're thinking of as the typical reader are people who are at least struggling with what they're experiencing. They know, sometimes they know they're in an echo chamber and they're trying to figure out, how do I get out of it? Some people in the echo chamber are perfectly comfortable there, and all they want to do is win and crush the other side. But I find in my own experience with students on the one hand, who tend to, at least at my place, lean more progressive, and then with more conservative people I meet in some religious settings, that there is this sense of, I do want to put a good faith effort into trying to understand these people that I don't understand, and what might I do? And so this could be maybe a modest first step to that end. It's not going to reach everybody at the polls, but it's going to get some people who are thinking, who are intuiting that it's not, that the fever is going to have to break at some point, that this is not going to be sustainable. This polarization and this distrust and fracture has to resolve somehow.
Yeah, I think that's definitely right. I mean, the last, what, 9 or so years, I would say, certainly from my various visits to America, it's always been a little bit polarized, going back to, I don't know, the founding fathers. They talked a lot of, I read the biography of Alexander Hamilton. They talked a lot of smack about each other
They
from
did.
the very beginning. I've seen what Alexander Hamilton called John Adams. It was not flattering. But it's certainly ratcheted up and being magnified through social media, and you've had the Trump phenomenon, January 6th. We've had COVID. We've now got the Gaza, Israel conflict. The Russia Ukraine war. These are all things that are playing out in cultural and political fractures. Do you see any hope for trying to get people to be more empathetic? Because my understanding of the book is really what you're saying is just try to see the world through someone else's eyes or someone else's experience and ask, why do they believe that? Maybe that if you don't, if it's not just imputing false motives to them, what makes them come to that? Try to understand someone else on their own grounds, on their own, see the world through their eyes. Do you think it's just going to get worse, or the point is going to come where people will move towards a middle? Maybe we'll all, rally around President Marco Rubio or something, or Michelle Obama as the. Do you see a way that we can come together, or do you think that the polarization is just going to increase and worse? Because this afternoon I'm planning to take my wife and go see a movie called Civil War. Which is about the United States, but that assumes that it does kind of get worse.
Right. I mean, you covered a lot in what you just said. And I think part of it is the appropriate recognition that there have been much starker periods of polarization and even violence in the history of the United States. So to guard against a certain form of presentism, that said, we're not headed in a very positive direction right now. And especially when you focus on the online stuff and the way the algorithms are working, the polls that are showing plummeting trust in institutions, especially the media, and really not just the presidential politics, but the national politics at all levels seem to be rather uninspiring when it comes to modeling something different. So does it shift, or does it get better? I hope so. And I hope that part of that is, I don't actually think that the answer is some kind of political moderation, because I think we have very different views of what's best for the country or where we need to head. And the policy outcome is seldom going to be the midpoint of those two views. But there is a mode of engagement in discourse that can be a little closer to you're wrong and I need to persuade you differently than you're evil and stupid and I need to annihilate you. And that's the real worrisome shift, because as we've seen in other settings, once you cross that line and once you sustain that line for too long, it's very hard to see the other side as human, let alone co-citizens who are part of a shared democratic experiment. And so that's the line that worries me. And I think to address it, we're going to need a better understanding of why people see things so differently and maybe why they're not evil or stupid, but why they have a different vision of the common good or their hope for society.
Yeah, and you have a chapter on that very thing, the difference between treating people as wrong and people as evil. Yeah, I would argue that that's probably one of the main features of our culture that is dragging us into everything is treated as the ultimate debate between good and evil, where they are these things are morally complex debates, like how you balance religious freedom with anti-discrimination law. That's not a black and white solution, what you do. And even debates like the Israel-Gaza conflict, I mean, that's not a black and white debate either. But people often act as if it is. The other thing I wanted to ask, and this is somewhat in jest, on a scale between 1 to 10, how much do you love Chief Justice Justice Kennedy as your favorite as your favorite jurist?
You know, it is funny how you frame that. You know, in a book where I'm trying to model a kind of generosity and tone, I did actually worry a bit about how I characterized and a little bit poked fun at Justice Kennedy. I think, you know, I met him once. He doesn't know me, but he seemed like a very nice, amicable guy. I wanted more mostly to call the reader's attention to the ways in which some of his writing and some of his attempts to do this kind of compromise, can't we just get along move, which in one hand is commendable and you know, you can understand his motives, and on the other hand, that's not going to work as constitutional law. That doesn't give us a test, it doesn't give us any principles, and so it feels a little bit aspirational and out of touch. The case I specifically call attention to is Masterpiece Cake Shop with the gay couple and the conservative Christian baker who doesn't want to bake the cake. And it's a hard case, and it's a case that doesn't often draw empathy from the other side, regardless of who the other side is. And there was a way in which Justice Kennedy just thought he could kind of smooth things out with some sing-songy language, and I just don't think that's going to work as a matter of constitutional doctrine. So I don't, you know, I think there have been better and worse decisions that he's written, and maybe that does not rise to the top.
Well, can't you all just be nice to each other? It is probably not a way you're going to solve constitutional conundrums. Final question for you, John. I tend to work mainly in church circles, Christian circles. I belong what you would call, you know, broadly evangelicalism. What do you think would be the benefits for, say, an evangelical audience in reading a book like this one, Learning to Disagree? Because I mean, we're already kind of on board with the idea of being peacemakers and reconciliation. That's kind of all in our wheelhouse. What do you think an explicitly Christian audience could take away from this book of yours?
Yeah, I mean, when you say it's in our wheelhouse, I would hope it is, right?
Maybe in theory, not always in actual application.
Right. But I think for Christians in particular, we of all people should be modeling this kind of generous disagreement. We shouldn't be afraid of questions about our faith, because if we're serious about the confidence that we have in the person and work of Jesus, that can absorb some hits, that can absorb some questions. If we're serious about seeing every human being as an image bearer, we have an obligation and a responsibility to live that out in the world. And if we're serious about knowing and affirming that we are just bit players in a much longer story that works out over thousands of generations, then the pressure is in some ways off. We still have to act responsibly and faithfully, but God and God's kingdom is not dependent upon what happens in 2024 in the United States or Australia or anywhere else in the world in particular, that this is a the restoration of the created order has begun and is accomplished. And that's a great place to start engaging with other human beings.
Yeah, that's a great way to put it. I like your point. What happens in 2024 is not going to change the fate of the world, no matter who's president. You know, the sun will still come up, Jesus is still Lord, and Chick-fil-A still makes great chicken. So, you know, that's still going to happen. Great. Well, John, it's been a pleasure to finally meet with you face to face. Like I said, I've been a big fan of your work. What's the best way to describe you? Would you be considered a political theorist or a legal philosopher?
Oh, great. Maybe neither. I mean, so legal philosopher sounds a little too
abstract
for what I do. I mean, I am trained as a political theorist, but because I spend most of my time in a law school, I think I'm just a legal scholar with some political theory insights, and maybe that's as good as we can do.
Well, that sounds good enough. Well, John, it's been a pleasure to talk with you. I'm sure the viewers will love watching this, and hopefully if they're out there, they'll definitely pick up a copy of the book. A very timely word in a fractious and fratricidal world, I have to say. So thank you, John, for the book. I think it's gonna be a great benefit and a great blessing to a good many people.
Thanks so much, Mike. It's been great to talk to you.
Hi, I'm Mike Bird, and you've been watching the channel Early Christian History. This is a channel where I put out a lot of stuff on the history of early Christianity, but I also, you know, focus on some specific issues related to the Bible, culture, political theology, or sometimes I just interview some really cool people like John Anadzu. So if you like that stuff, check out the other stuff, the other episodes that are around, and I look forward to seeing you somewhere around the channel.